Now I had the time of my life. No, I never felt like this before. Yes, I swear it's a truth, and I owe it all to you.
'Cause I had the time of my life, and I owe it all to you.
And again, we begin with a little bit of music here on Westchester Eye on the Radio, our weekly discussion of issues relating to Westchester and the surrounding area. I'm John Charan, along with Ardina Seward, and our third member of our group, Peter Moses, is out again for personal reasons today. And, you know, Ardina, I got in here. It was nice and a little bit drizzly when I came in here. And I look outside, and right now it looks like I pretty much need a canoe to get to my car when the show's going to end.
We're
going to
need, where's Noah? We need him.
Indeed. Indeed. And how are you today?
I'm good. You know, the roads were wild and crazy, and hopefully people will not turn it into the Indy 500. You know, I think that everybody knows, well, most people know that you're supposed to slow down
Bobby,
in that rain.
Bobby! What does a yellow light mean?
One of my great favorite lines of all time from the TV show Taxi, where Reverend Jim is taking the driver's test, and he can't figure out the answers. And so he leans over and asks for some help. And he asks that question, and Bobby says, "Slow down.
Okie doke. What does a yellow light mean?
Slow down.
Okay. What? Duh."
And it goes on. But it's, I mean, I'm not a comedian. It's not funny when I do it. But when Christopher Lloyd does it, it has me in tears and rolling in the aisles. And so, yes, hopefully on the road, when people see adverse driving conditions like we have right now, they will know to slow down.
And speaking of slowdown, we're going to, Alex Mintz, the fabulous sound engineer, just slowed us down at the beginning of the show with the theme song from Dirty Dancin.
Indeed. And why is that relevant to today's show, Ardina?
Well, you've heard of Dancing in the Rain, right?
Oh, I've also heard of Singing in the Rain with Gene Kelly.
Well, we have the author of I Had the Time of My Life on with us today. His name is Frank Previte. We have Frank on the line. And I don't know if anybody's going to be doing any dirty dancing in the rain, Frank, but they'll be listening in the rain. So
right.
Tell us about your... first of all, you know, I got to ask you. You were born and raised in New Brunswick, New Jersey. Your dad apparently was an opera singer, and you became a songwriter and didn't get yourself involved in opera. So how did you diverge from the music classics?
Well, before I start, I have a message that was sent to me. I just got it, and it's from Noah. He's sending an ark.
It's nice to know somebody has a personal connection.
Well, to get to your question, my dad, yes, my father was born in Sicily, and my mother was also Italian, and so there was my father was an opera singer, and there was always this music going on in my house. My mother and father met taking voice lessons from the same vocal coach, so there were a lot of Italian notes going on in my house, with my father learning different arias and operas that he was in. And so, you know, for me as a young guy growing up, I was influenced by that, but I realized that, you know, there was a whole other world that I wanted to explore that had blue notes in it, you know, as opposed to these long, big Italian notes. And so, you know, at the age of, you know, 11 and 12, I started putting groups, a cappella groups, together with myself and you know, four black guys, and then a group called Frankie Love and the Intruders. And these groups, I started listening to a band that really influenced me in 1963 and 64 called the Young Rascals.
Mm-hmm.
And so that group, along with Bill Medley and Bobby Hatfield, really turned me and turned my attention to the Blue Notes, and that, you know, that's the type of singer that I wanted to emulate. And I realized that at 15, because I got signed to London Records, that it was about writing songs. It was about trying to create your own sound and music. So my dad was the impetus of me, you know, and the genetic pool from my parents that gave me the voice. But I realized that, you know, I wanted to do more of a street thing than an opera thing. So that's kind of where it led me.
And we are getting close to our second commercial break. Our first commercial break. First news break, as John has corrected me. So we're going to talk more about your music career and your new recordings. We are Westchester Island Radio, and our guest today is Frank Previte, P-R-E-V-I-T-E, and I hope I'm not massacring your name.
We'll get to that.
We'll get to that, yeah. I figure I'm terrible on names. But stay with us, folks. Keep your radios tuned and keep your dancing feet ready.
Let's return now to Westchester Eye on the Radio with Peter Moses, John Charan, and Ardina Seward on 1460 WVOX.
Wow, I really like that song.
You should. Most of America did, because in 1981 it rose to number 10 on the Billboard pop charts.
Well, I hate to sound ancient, but you don't hear music like that anymore.
And maybe we can talk to our guest about that.
So Frank, and it's...
I'm sorry, who's our guest?
Frank Previte.
How about Frank Previte?
Frank Previte. There's so many. This is like, you know, the permutation of his name. There's so many ways to say it.
Well, there's a lot of vowels there.
Yeah,
a lot of
just
vowels.
Don't call me late for dinner.
There you go.
How about Frankie Pre? I like that. Frankie Pre. That has a certain ring to it. But, you know, one of the things, I want to talk about a couple of things. First of all, that song, which has one heck of a beat and rhythm, and two, You have some new music out, a new CD, a new album.
Yeah, I do. You know, it was kind of cool hearing that on the radio when you guys just played it, was that not only reminding me of the song, but that was the live version of the song.
Oh, wow.
Well, that was Franke and the Knockouts live.
Mm.
And I could tell by the arrangement, because we arranged it at the end of the chorus a little differently than we recorded it on the record. And I was like, oh, wow, that's the live version. So well, that's very cool. I like that you guys did that. So to get to this new album that is coming out, Joe Rigoso from Friday Music, which is a division of Sony, and... he called me up and said he would like to put together all three of the Knockout records. And I thought, you know, there's the third Knockout record that came out. Instead of being on Millennium Records, they sold us to MCA. And MCA really dropped the ball on that record. And so it gave me a chance to really get that third record heard. And then I said to Joe, what I'd like to do is that I'd like to take about 10 or 11 songs from when I started. I was in a band called Bull Angus in 1973 and 74 that played with Rod Stewart and Deep Purple and Fleetwood Mac, and were on Mercury Records. And I'd like to take some demos from that band. And then I was an artist on Buddha Records as an R&B singer in the late 70s. And I'd like to take some songs that didn't make it from on those records, and then some Franke and the Knockout songs that didn't make the record, and kind of have bonus tracks. So on this new compilation are 11 demos, unreleased songs from my past. And then I said, and let's finish this up with 5 or 6 songs of Franke and the Knockouts live, so people can hear, because we always thought of ourselves as a rock and roll band, and radio kind of pegged us as a pop band. Right. And I said, well, we're a little bit of both. So let's let, you know, people hear what a pop rock and roll band sounds like. Because I don't think the records ever really justified us. So I, with all of that said, Joe was like, all right, let's do this record. So it's the Franke and the Knockouts collection.
Is that what it's called?
It's called the Franke and the Knockouts, I believe it is, collection. Darn it.
And that now that that is in the, that can be ordered online now, or that is in
Yes, if you go to FridayMusic.com, or you can go to Amazon. You can actually go to my Facebook page, which is Franke and the Knockouts, and there's places there where you can order the record through Friday Music, FridayMusic.com. And Friday Music is really a cool place because not only did they put out Franke and the Knockouts, but they probably have a good 100 to 150 bands from the past, like Billy Joel, like the Monkees, like Todd Rundgren, you know, Doobie Brothers, and they have their original first, second, and third records that you can't get anymore. Friday Music puts them out.
Wow. Now, I have a question. John, did you want to ask something?
No, that's okay.
I want to ask you about, you, apparently you are still touring.
Yes.
Have a friend, Renee White, who's been on the show, and Renee was part of, not part of, Renee was one of the founding members of the Chantels. And she's been around for many, many years, and she is still touring. It's not with the original group because it's changed a lot. They still do some of the old songs. But, you know, of course, it's different, the voice quality, the song quality, and it's a whole new generation of fans. So
sure.
how is your touring experience now, and how does it compare to back in the day?
Well, here's the difference. Instead of touring with Franke and the Knockouts, I wrote kind of a jukebox musical that is a combination of a play in the first act that turns into a full-blown concert in the second act. And it's a little bit of my life story, but it's about four different girls, all at different ages. It's called Calling All Divas. And these girls compete to become the next superstar. And a guy that, a young songwriter, he sends out Franke, find this next, you know, superstar girl. And Franke is looking for the next unforgettable voice to sing his song. And these girls all compete. Now they're at different stages of their careers. One is in her 50s, one's 40s and 30s, and then there's one that we find in the subway. One's a subway singer, and she's 19. So these four different girls kind of realize that they're stronger together as they start to sing and compete. They realize that, you know, there's a sisterhood amongst them, and they start rooting for each other. And so the guy that has to make one of them a star is kind of baffled because he doesn't know which one to pick because he likes them all. And so the second act is the winner of who he picks, and that becomes a concert. And at the end of that concert, they say, there really is a Franke, and he really did write a hit song, and I come out and sing Time of My Life with the girls.
and where can people see this show?
Well, we've done it at the Keswick Theater right outside of Philly. We've done it a couple of times in Manhattan at a theater. And we're playing in July 11th at the Pollock Theater, which is on the campus of Monmouth College. And then we go to the Palace Theater in Pittsburgh on July 19th, and then Hershey, Pennsylvania. And then we do six dates down in Florida in November, November 5th through the 11th.
Well, that's an interesting schedule you've got lined up there, Frank. We're speaking with Frank Previte, who's a singer-songwriter of some renown. We've heard some of his music so far. We're going to talk more about his involvement with the music industry and his future plans. You are listening to Westchester Eye on the Radio here on WVOX 1460 AM and heard worldwide at WVOX.com. I'm John Turan, along with Ardina Seward. And like I say, we are talking songs today, so stay tuned.
Let's return now to Westchester Eye on the Radio with Peter Moses, John Charan, and Ardina Seward on 1460 WVOX.
And we'll begin our second half hour with our traditional music here on Westchester Eye on the Radio. I'm John Charan, along with Ardina Seward. And our guest today, a phone-in guest, is singer-songwriter Franke Previte, who's known for Franke and the Knockouts, and also for his work in writing the song I've Had the Time of My Life from the film Dirty Dancing. He also did the song Hungry Eyes. And I'm curious, Franke, after Franke and the Knockouts disbanded, that's when you went and started doing these individual singles. How did you transition from producing and performing as a group to being an individual songwriter who was actually writing for others?
It was interesting. After we got dropped from MCA and I came back home, I started writing, trying to get another record deal for myself. And I got a call 2 years later from Jimmy Einer, who was the president of Millennium Records that Franke and the Knockouts was on.
Mm-hmm.
And so he sounded me about writing for Dirty Dancing. But he said to me, listen, I have this little movie. I'd like you to write a song for it. And I said, Jimmy, I'm really trying to get another deal. And I had already written Hungry Eyes for the next Franke and the Knockouts record that no one liked. There was no record label that heard that as a hit record. And he said to me, well, make time. This is going to change your life. And I was thinking, yeah, right. You're going to change my life. And he goes, I got a good feeling about this little movie. And I go, all right, what's the name of the movie? And he said to me, Dirty Dancing. And when he said that, I remember putting my hand on my forehead thinking, oh, my God, Jimmy's doing porn.
And so after you got past that.
Yes, he said, no, it's really a good little movie. And he gave me like a 5-minute description of, you know, Johnny meets baby and the father hates the kid. But they end up at the movie and in the movie at the end seeing that they're together. And so he said, the good news is you're going to write a song for a movie. The bad news is that the scene that you have to write it for is the last scene of the movie and it's 7 minutes long.
Wow.
Mm.
And I'm thinking MacArthur Park here, you know.
Sure.
And so I called John DeNicola, who I wrote Hungry Eyes with, and I gave him kind of an idea of what was going on, and I said, you know what, let's start the song up front with the chorus, and we'll do it kind of like in halftime, and then we'll hit the verse, and we'll hit the downbeat of the verse, and we'll double time it. So the song was written, and I was blessed to have been nominated and won an Academy Award for the song. So when I met Patrick Swayze at the Academy Awards, he was very inquisitive and wanted to know who sang the song, who wrote the song. And I'm like, oh, okay. And I said, well, I co-wrote it and I sang it with Rochelle Capelli. And I said, why is that so important to you? He goes, because we hated this movie. I go, what do you mean you hated this movie? He goes, well, let me clarify that. He goes, we had listened to 149 songs and turned them all down. And we filmed out of sequence. We filmed the last scene first.
Mm-hmm.
And so we were getting ready to film to a song that we didn't really like. It wasn't an original song. And your cassette came in. And we said, we're making the movie to that song. And he goes, at the end of the day, he goes, we just turned around and we looked at each other and went, oh, my God, what just happened?
Wow.
And he said the camaraderie for this movie went from, you know, did like a 180. And it was like, oh, my God, let's go make a movie. This ending is unbelievable.
Mm-hmm.
And then said the second day we filmed to you singing Hungry Eyes. And he goes, so those songs, that time of my life, kind of changed the whole, you know, demeanor of how everybody felt about this movie. And so I was like really taken back, you know, here I am going to sit in my seat to to you know, hear who wins an Academy Award, and I hear the story, and I'm like, oh my God, that just blew me away.
And you, by your writing talents, were able to actually create a mood for what became one of the most popular romantic movies of the late 1980s. And I'm curious, when it comes to creating, for you, is it a matter of getting a concept of the idea first and then trying to find melody or lyrics? Or is it a case of, well, I have these lyrics and how do I fit them in? Or is it a case of, I have this melody and what can I build around it? What works for you?
John, that's a great question. And here's the answer. For everyone, you know, they have their own idiosyncrasies how they write. For me, it has to be melody first. And so as I find the piece of music, and sometimes in writing that piece of music with another player, because I'm not really a player, I'm a singer.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, if I'm writing with someone and they're playing some changes and I'm jamming, and then they go to the chorus and I don't hear that as where I think it should go, I say, stop playing when it hits the chorus and I'll sing you where I think it should go. And so for me to get this track from John D. Nicola, I was sitting in the car on the Garden State Parkway jamming to this cassette that was in my dashboard, going at exit 140, paying the toll in Union, New Jersey, going, nin, and I'm of my life, nin, and I'm of my life. And I'm scribbling time of my life on an envelope.
Mm-hmm.
And so from the music and from the melody, these phonetic words and sounds come out of me, and it usually, when I hit the chorus, my inner seed is telling me what I think this song should be about. I had no idea really what this movie was about. I didn't have a script. I hadn't read anything, just Jimmy telling me Johnny baby and the father doesn't like the kid. So the man upstairs wrote the song.
And you know, it's funny you bring that up that way, because our missing co-host Peter Moses and I both began as newspaper writers, and we began, you know, in the world of writing. And my favorite little bit of inspiration when people ask me how do you become a writer, there's a comic strip out there called Shoo, which is about a flock of birds that actually take on human characteristics, and one of them is a newspaper editor. And the copy girl, a stork, comes up to Mr. Schumacher, a blackbird, she says, Mr. Schumacher, how does one become a great writer? And he says, well, my dear, it's very simple. First, you grab a clean piece of paper and carefully roll it into the typewriter. Then you get a comfortable chair and assume a position at just the right distance from the keys. Finally, stare at that keyboard until little beads of blood appear on your forehead. And that is, I think, you know, one of these things. Inspiration comes from many different sources, but you can't force it. It's going to happen on its own.
Yes, I agree 100%. You know, it's kind of that inner seed. And I can remember being 15 years old and an artist on London Records, and thinking that, you know, this original music I was writing was the greatest, you know, and you realize when you listen to your original pieces why, you know, it didn't make it. It's a process that you have to live and breathe it and cultivate it and water it. And as you do that, not everyone is lucky enough to be successful, but it's a process. You know, there are the prodigies, the Bruce Springsteens and the Bob Dylans, and then there's the rest of them.
And that's a good time to make a stop for our final break. You're listening to Westchester Eye on the Radio here on WVOX 1460 AM and heard worldwide at WVOX.com. I'm John Charan, along with Ardina Seward and our special phone-in guest, singer-songwriter Frank Previte.
With world and national. Chester Eye on the Radio with Peter Moses, John Charan, and Ardina Seward on 1460 WVOX.
Oh,
And that's the beginning of the song Hungry Eyes, sung by Eric Carmen and made a hit in 1987. But the writer of that song, singer-songwriter, is on with us today, Franke Previte. He also wrote that song, which appeared in the film Dirty Dancing. He also wrote the most memorable song from that film, I've Had the Time of My Life, for which he won the Academy Award for Best Original Song. And Franke, I'm wondering if you might indulge me a little here. My all-time favorite song is the final hit by the second most sold singer in terms of songs from the 1950s, Ricky Nelson. And that final hit was Garden Party. And the final stanza for that song said, if you've got to play at garden parties, I wish you a lot of luck. But if memories were all I sang, I'd rather drive a truck. And I think, and his emphasis there was that as an artist, you cannot stay in the past. You have to be like a shark and swim forward. You have to keep moving ahead. How have you seen your music evolve over the years to the point where you are today, from what it was back in the 80s to where you are today?
Well, you know, it's a matter of happenstances that happen to you in your life. And then, obviously, staying in the game is a big part of it. You know, a lot of people get frustrated and, you know, they maybe have a semi-hit or don't ever have a hit, and they you know, decide they want to do something else with their lives. So for me, I've always been a person that had this belief in myself as a songwriter and as an entertainer, and so I never gave up the dream. I sold cars out of my driveway so I could continue not to have to play in cover bands and to make enough money to take voice lessons. And so it's about, you know, you got to be in it to win it. And so with that said, obviously, you have to have the God-given talent and then the opportunity to have that talent, you know, find its place in time. So writing songs, who would have ever guessed in a million years that this little kid from New Brunswick, Franke Previte, would write an Academy Award, Golden Globe, and Grammy-nominated song? That wasn't my dream. My dream was to hear myself on the radio one day. So I've lived beyond my dream, and then to have a song, Time of My Life, today that sold 55 million records and become kind of a classic. And I don't say that like braggadocio. I say that as because of the amount of people that I've met around the world that know that song. And it just has touched the hearts of the world. And the song actually, when A Time of My Life first and the movie came out, RCA Records and Vestron Films weren't on the same page. And so RCA put the record out, and it started to go up the AC charts, the Adult Contemporary charts. And Vestron Films said, well, by the way, we've moved the movie back a month. And so RCA said, well, we're dropping the song. And so Vestron Films said, well, we're just going to put it out for 2 weeks, and then we'll go directly to DVD. And so within that two-week period when they put it out, there was no promotion, there was no RCA Records, but there was 300,000 people that went to the record stores and back-ordered Time of My Life. And before RCA could print a record, there was 1 million records back-ordered. So the real phenomenon is that the public created this phenomenon. Patrick Swayze, Jennifer Grey, Eleanor Bergstein's little movie, and this song. If you take one of those elements out, you don't have the same phenomenon. So that, to me, is part of my history of being a songwriter and being able to be flexible and to write other genres, not only saying, oh, this is who I am as an artist, and I'm not going to write anything else. So if I feel it and it's a good groove and it's an R&B groove, I write a song to it. If it's a rock and roll groove that hits me and touches me, I write a song to it.
Oh, I hate to cut you off, but we're getting into our final minute and a half of the show. So I want to talk, I guess, in 30 seconds about your your contributions to the Pancreatic Cancer Foundation, which is very important.
Sure.
And how people go about doing that, who they contact, and we have to be quick because we're up against the clock.
Here it is. You go to my Facebook page. It's called Dirty Dancing Demos. They are the original songs that Patrick and Jennifer danced to with me singing it with Rochelle Capelli, Hungry As in Time of My Life. And through the past 25 years, I've probably sold $30,000 worth of those demos that I've donated to pancreatic cancer. It's called the Pancreatic Cancer Action Network, and it's Franke and the Knockouts. You can go on that, but go to Dirty Dancing Demos on my Facebook page, and it'll give you a way to purchase those demos, a piece of history for Dirty Dancing fans.
And don't forget that Calling All Divas, Frankie's expose, his demonstration, his cabaret, is going to be at July 11th at Monmouth College, and I'm sure that you can contact Monmouth College and find out more about it there if you want tickets.
Yeah, it's the Pollock Theater, right at Monmouth College.
Mm-hmm.
Well, thanks so much, Frank, for being a guest on the show, and good on you for your work with the Pancreatic Cancer Foundation. So we are.
Thank you, Ardina. Thank you, John, for letting me tell my story and having me on today.
Thanks, Frankie.
Next week, we will have, hopefully, Jeffrey Diskovic on the phone. Jeffrey was falsely imprisoned for a long, long, long time. He's out now, and he's studying for his bar exam. He's going to be a lawyer, and he's going to tell us all about it. So check us out next week, folks. Westchester Eye on the Radio, and have a good dry week.
And with any luck, we'll be back with our co-host Peter Moses next week. So everybody, have a great week.
Never felt this way before.
Never felt.
Yes, I swear, it's the truth, and I hope it.